the first day. Here ends the reading of the first lesson.
The psalm today is Psalm 2, on page 215. Why are the nations in an uproar?
Why do the peoples mutter empty threats?
Why do the kings of the earth rise up in revolt and the princes plot together?
Against the Lord and against his anointed.
Let us break their yoke, they say.
Let us cast off their bonds from us.
He whose throne is in heaven is laughing.
The Lord has them in derision.
Then he speaks to them in his wrath.
And his rage fills them with terror.
I myself have set my king
upon my holy hill of Zion.
Let me announce the decree of the Lord.
He said to me, "You are my son. This day I have begotten you."
Ask of me, and I will give you the nations of your inheritance,
and the ends of the earth for your possession.
You shall crush them with an iron rod,
and shatter them like a piece of pottery.
And now, you kings, be wise.
Be warned, you rulers of the earth.
Submit to the Lord with fear,
and with trembling bow before him,
lest he be angry and you perish.
For his wrath is quickly kindled.
Happy are they all
who take refuge in him. The second lesson is from Isaiah, chapter 45, verse 5. And really, I'll read just the first half of the verse. And the Lord said, I am the Lord, there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. Here ends the reading of the second lesson. Please rise. And the third lesson for today is from St. Paul's letter to the Colossians, the first chapter, beginning with the 15th verse. And St. Paul writes the following by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, and in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Here ends the reading of the lesson. You may be seated.
That you have gathered us this morning in the presence of your Son, For he has promised that we will be gathered in his name. There he is in the midst of us. So we welcome you, Lord Jesus. We praise your name. You are worthy of all honor and praise and glory and worship. And we are just thankful that you are our God and our Savior. Lord, we come to you today for so many reasons. For we are needy people. And only in you can we find satisfaction from what we need. And so Lord, we ask you to open up our eyes to see, our ears to hear, and our hearts to receive. Open up our spirits, Lord, so that what we receive today can be deep in our hearts and bear fruit for eternal life. Lord, Holy Spirit, be our teacher this moment now. And we pray that the word of my mouth and meditations of our hearts would be truly acceptable in your sight, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Grace and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Last week, we began this series on discussing the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, and even the Athanasian Creed, and talking about the biblical basis for what it is that we're confessing in church. Because it's important that we understand why we do things so that we can gain the spiritual benefit of doing it. First of all, we are reminded that making a public confession of our faith is something that we find in the Bible. It's something that we're called to do because we overcome Satan. We enter in with the blessings of God when we confess with our mouths what our heart believes. Secondly, we are reminded that when we say the creeds, we are speaking Bible. We are talking what the Bible says about God and about us. And we are making a personal confession saying, I believe. So in other words, we have an intimate relationship with the Lord. This is our faith and we will stand on it. But we also say, we believe in that we are the family of God and we stand together on this same precious faith. And what we say in these creeds identifies us as the body of Christ and also identifies who's not part of the body so that we can do evangelism and outreach to them. Now today, I want us to consider the first article of both the Apostles and Nicene Creed. So I'm actually going to be using the Nicene Creed version of the first article because it's a little fuller, a little more detailed. And I want us to consider the biblical basis for what it is that we are saying there. In that first article, we say this. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. And with these words, we are saying something very important to the people of the world, to the people in our church, to the invisible world, both the angels of God, the throne of God, and also our enemies. We are saying these very important biblical words. And we're saying, this is where we stand. The first thing that we are declaring for everyone to hear is that we believe in one God. One. Not two. Not three, not 10, not 18, one. And one God means a couple of things. First of all, we are letting people know who might be confused that when we say we believe in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are not saying that we believe in three gods. We believe in one God in three persons. But we do not believe in three gods. The Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God. God is all three. That's what we're saying. But there's something else that we're also saying here. We are saying what we find in Isaiah 45, verse 5. In Isaiah 45, verse 5, we hear the Lord himself saying, I am the Lord, besides me there is no God. So in other words,
What we're saying here is in agreement with the Bible, which says that there is only ever one God, and everything else that is worshipped, anything else that human beings want to bring glory to, is either the creation of the human imagination, the creation of Satan, or both. And we will not bend the knee and worship and give honor and glory to anything else that wants worship. The only thing and the only person whom we will worship is God alone. That's very important, especially nowadays. Because one of the things we need to understand is that this day and age really isn't all that different than the days of the past in this respect. There have, from the beginning, been many different, quote, gods and lords and many different things to worship. And they have always been calling the people of God to accept them as worthy and equal in worship as God. You want to know what got the people of Israel in trouble with God and got them exiled ultimately? God is alone God. There is no other besides Him. And yet when they entered into the promised land, what did they start to do? They started to also worship the other gods of the land. And what they ended up doing was they were worshiping God on the Sabbath, and then also sacrificing to these other gods, and they were living their lives as if everything that claims to be God is one and the same. All ways lead to heaven, all ways lead to blessing, for this worship everything. And we'll be fine. But that's a lie. There is only one who is God, and everything else is a demonic spirit. In fact, the Old Testament says as much, that the false gods are nothing but demons that were worshipped through these idols of stone and wood. So what we need to understand is that when we say we believe in one God, we are also saying to our society, which has many gods, that we will not bend the knee and accept that all gods are equal. There is only one who is God, and all the others are divine. And we will not honor them. We will not worship them. We will not say that it's okay to worship them. And we will not bend the knee to them with the rest of society and say, this is just fine. We will stand only for God. We will worship only God. We will not say that Allah is equal to the God of the Bible. We will not say that Buddha is just fine. We will not say that Vishnu is equal to the Almighty. We will say there is only one God, and we're willing to stand, kneel, and die for it, but we will not give up that confession. And we will not compromise with the world. These are non-negotiables. There is only one who is worthy of all honor and praise and worship and glory. And we will serve only Him. So when we are saying we believe in one God, we are not only telling the world who might be confused that the Trinity is not three gods, it's just one. But we are telling the world that's filled with false gods that they are not God. They're not worthy of worship. And we will not join them in worshiping what is divine. We will only worship the one true God. Now, that being said, we also say of God that not only is He one and the only God, but we are saying that He is our Father. God is our Father. How did He become our Father? He becomes our Father through the cross of Jesus. We are saying that God, who is the righteous judge, has become our Father, and we are His children, and we expect every good thing from Him because Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. And now, God is no longer a judge against us, but a Father who is for us. And we have become children of God and heirs of the kingdom. So we are saying that God is not only one, but He is our Father, and we look to Him for every good thing. This is what our Lord Jesus is talking about when He tells us in
in the Lord's Prayer that we are to say, Our Father. We can trust God through Jesus to provide every good thing. As we read also in Scripture, that every good and precious gift comes from the Father of lights. So not only is God one, but He's a personal God. He's our Father. And He loves us. And we love Him. And we expect that He will take care of us. But that's not all we say. We also say that we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty. Almighty. Almighty means there is nothing that God can't do. Nothing. In other words, we serve a God of miracles. We serve a God of power. We serve a God who can do all things. We serve a God who can raise the dead, cast out demons, heal the sick, make us new, fill us with the Holy Spirit, bring His kingdom, and cast out Satan forever. We serve a God who's able to create out of nothing. By the way, you know what's fascinating? Is that, you know, my daughter, for example, is taking an advanced biology class, and one of the things they're talking about at the beginning of the class is creation. They didn't call it that, but that's what they're talking about. And one of the things that scientists and those in the class could not seem to grasp, and it's not their fault, none of us can grasp it, all right? How do you create out of nothing? See, can you imagine nothing? I can't. You know why we can't imagine nothing? Because nothing means nothing. No molecules. Nothing physical. Nothing at all. Not a thing. Which means that there's no laws of creation. There's no laws of physics. There's no laws of gravity. Nothing. Try to get your mind around that. And good luck to you. But we have a God who created out of nothing. He spoke and it came to be. And now all we have is something. Both invisible and visible. You know, I was reminded of that very fact in a joke that came out of that science class that Rachel was telling me. I've heard it before. It's a good one. So these scientists decide, you know, we become so advanced, we don't need God anymore. So they sent one of their scientists to go tell God that they don't need Him anymore. So the scientist goes up to the Almighty, says, well, we thank you very much for all that you've done, but we really don't need you anymore because we've got all this technology now, we can do everything for ourselves. So if you don't mind, just leave us alone. And God smiled and said, you don't need me anymore. It's like the scientist said, no. And God said, well, I disagree. I think we need to be alive. And the scientist said, well, I don't think so, because we can do anything you did. And God says, really? All right, well, let's have a contest. And the scientist says, fine. You name it. Make it personal. And the scientist says, no problem, I'll just grab a little dirt here, take a little water, and God says, you make your own dirt, your own water. See, human beings cannot make anything. We can invent, but we're only using what's already there. God created out of nothing. That's a staggering thought. He is almighty. There is nothing that's impossible for Him. Which our Lord Jesus said, by the way, when, remember the rich young man that came to Him, wanted to know how to get saved? And Jesus finally said to him, when you sell everything that you own, give it to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. And the man went away sad, because he had great wealth. And Jesus said of the rich, how hard it will be for the rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. His apostles are amazed at the statement. They said, how then can anyone be saved? And Jesus says, for man this is impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible. Almighty. It means there isn't anything going on in your life that God can't solve and God can't make right, or that God can't bring to holiness. He can do it all. But I want to say this one thing. We said that God is almighty. He can do all things. Now, some smart guy might say, oh, really? He can do everything? Let me just help with that. There is one thing that God cannot do. And it's actually good news. You know what it is? He can't lie. He can't go against his own character. He can't go against his own word. And it's good news because it means that when he says he will do this for you, you can count on it. He will do this for you. When he says he will give you eternal life when you believe in Jesus Christ, you can count on it. You will receive eternal life. When he says you will be forgiven, you can count on it. You will be forgiven. When he says anyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved, you can count on it. You call on the name of the Lord, you will be saved. He's almighty. The only thing he can do is go against his own word and his own character. And that's good news. Because it means that the 8,000 promises that he made to his people in the Bible, you can count on it, those promises will come to pass at some point in your existence, either in this life or in the life to come. But you will receive all 8,000. That's good news. That's what we're saying. But finally, we're saying that not only is God one, not only is he our Father, not only is he almighty, he can do everything, but we're also saying that he is the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen or unseen. And when we're saying that he is the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen, we're saying a couple of things. First of all, we're saying what we read in Genesis chapter 1 and in Colossians chapter 1. We're saying that everything that exists, both visible and invisible, no matter where it is, comes from God. God is the one who created everything. There isn't anything that exists that has its existence except by God. So whatever's out there, God made it. That's why when someone says to me, and I've heard this before, well, Pastor, if we ever found life on another planet, that would make the Bible not true. I'm like, what? Really? You think that would make the Bible untrue? If we find life anywhere, God. I mean, we're finding planets all over the place. Who made them? God. In the Bible, and in this case that we made in the creeds, we are saying anything, anywhere, whether we can see it or not, whether it's physical or spiritual, all of it originated with Almighty God. So understand that wherever life is, God made it, created it. Even if it's in rebellion right now, it originated with God. You know, everything was created good, right? But not everything stayed good. The fallen angels didn't stay good. The human race didn't stay good. But that doesn't keep us from having been made by God. That we rebel is our problem. God created us and created us good. So understand that everything originates from God. But now, here's the other thing that's being said. Not only is everything that's created coming from God, but it also means that God established the physical and spiritual and moral laws upon which everything is to live, and by which everything is to live. So when you look at the laws of physics or nature, God created them. When you look at spiritual laws, calling for forgiveness and love, and obedience, God created them. Or when you're talking about the human natural law, the human moral law, God created that too. All of that is from God. And when we're saying that God made these things, we're also saying that we are going to submit
and obey the rules that God established in the created order, we're not going to tinker with them. Because if we tinker with them, bad things happen. And if you don't believe bad things happen when you tinker with what God created, go back to Adam and Eve. God created everything good. Everything was working. And if Adam and Eve had obeyed God, everything would still be in working order perfectly. But that didn't happen. Instead, they listened to the enemy and decided to tinker with what God had created. Eve ate the fruit, Adam ate the fruit, and we all know what happened afterwards. We're all still suffering the consequences of death and disease and evil because of that very first tinkering with the creation. And let me say right now, when we see the enemy and quote human wisdom tinkering with what God established, the only thing that can happen ultimately is great evil and hardship and confusion. You see, now I'm going to tell you something that's shocking. All right, now I don't want you to get up and leave. I want you to listen, all right, because this is very important. When God created you, you were actually made either a boy or a girl. Now, I know that's shocking, but you were. You are in fact male or female. God made that law. You don't need to fight with it. You need to find your place in it and live it out. And yet we now have a society where people are so confused about that, they think that it was human society that created male and female. And therefore they can go ahead and change whatever they want to change. I was at a youth group, and one boy, he was a kid, but one boy came up to the other pastor that was there, and the pastor had used the male pronoun, him. And the boy said, "Are you assuming my gender?" And the pastor said, "Yes, I am. And I will continue to do so." And if you're confused, we have some diagrams here for you to show you the difference. But that's what happens when you start tinkering with things of God. You bring confusion, you bring heartache, and you bring destruction to the human family, to human community, to human life. It's a work of the devil. What we're saying in this creed is that God has established certain laws and norms. They're not human created, they're God created. And we are not going to submit to the forces of the world. But we are going to stand and submit to the Word of God and to the order that He's established. Because that is the only order where there is life and joy and peace. And it's the only order that's authorized for human beings to live in. Anything else we were not intended to live in. We're just living in death and not in life. And so today, let's remember that we're really saying in this creed that there's only one God, we will worship no other, no matter what society is doing. That He is our Father. He provides all things necessary for life and godliness. That He is almighty. There's nothing He cannot do. And that He's the maker of all things, which means not only the maker of what we see, the maker of every law that governs what He made, and we will submit to those laws rather than seek to tinker with them and break them, because breaking leads to death and not to life. In Jesus' name, Amen. Our next hymn is 56 in the regiment.
Come on.
mercy upon them.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated in the altar.
To our places of the body of Christ, that the fruit of the Spirit grow in us, so that people will taste and see that the Lord is good. That Lord, you can send us out into our communities and families to give glory to the name of Jesus. And that, Lord, as we share what you've done for us, that you will go before us and lift up your hand and heal with miracles, with wonders, and signs attendant. That people would meet you and give you the glory that belongs to you and turn their lives over to you and be saved. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you've commanded us to pray for the righteousness and peace of Jerusalem. And so we pray, Lord, that you would fulfill your word in Zechariah 12:10, where the people of Israel and Jerusalem would recognize you, the one who cares more over you is for an only son. And Lord, they'd be cleansed by your blood, filled by your spirit, and be joined in your church as the one new man who gave you the glory. And Lord, we pray too that you would protect Israel from her enemies and bring her to true repentance. We ask this, Lord, in your name. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, you are the healer, and by your stripes we are healed. And so we just pray the healing that you purchase on Calvary's Hill. And in the lives of Brian Jerobus, Robert Jernison, Aspen Heisler, Ed Werner, Chamberlain Van Sleet, Mel Morales, Lois Jenkinson, and Cora Martha, Bryce Johnson, Robert Empty, Jim Chose, Terry Rosecrans, Joy Shirley, Dave Sullivan, Kathy Israel, Ben Vesterson, Jenny Westby, Marilyn Morstead, Doug Holtzizer, Elena Schofield, Kate Reagan, Lillian Erickson, Tyler Halverson, Bruce Tilt, Jake O'Brien, Jacob Foster, Louis Hertzman, Audrey Pulse, Adam Beck, Donnie Peterson, Doug Sorry, Oliver Sorry, Kathy Schaefer, Diane Hills, Linda Gallo, Douglas Hurstman, Lois Larson, Roma Cahara, Monica Park, Dorothy Johnson, Gianna Kapar, Joe McMurlin, Keith Burke, Barry James Lundgren, Terry Lundquist, Joe Freitag, Kayla Samuelson, and Vicki. And Lord, we also pray for our military personnel, Michael Rasmussen, Shane Campbell, Captain Renata, Caleb Dyer, Kevin and Elijah McKenzie, Scott Brown, Robin, Trevor Simmons, Jonathan DeFoe, Isaiah Bird, David Bird, and Sammy East. And Lord, we pray your blessings on all those we mentioned now and out loud or in our heart.
Lord, I pray.
Healing for Dory Johnson.
I pray for our brothers and sisters at Gilgit, and I pray, Father, Lord, we've got a drug epidemic going on in this state and in our country here. I mean, we're just losing thousands and thousands of people to this epidemic of drugs, Lord. I just pray that people will open their hearts and minds to what they're doing to themselves, Father, when they start this, get into this. And I just pray that for your healing and a hand on so many, Lord, and that this will be stopped in Jesus' name. Praise God.
Thank you. Lord, I pray salvation for Sarah, her family, and she and Kevin Porter, Silas Brown, Vincent France. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all who we pray, trusting in your mercy for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And as we are his disciples on earth, let us pray as our Lord Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now the Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face and shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you in favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
For his servant crucified and risen Lord, thanks be to God.
All right, let's sing our final hymn, hymn number 19, in the red hymnal.
Warm up. Now we're really going to get into it.